Hey guys, how are you all? My name is Harshit Devedi, friends, and I welcome you back to my video. So in this video, friends, I will be discussing with you regarding Sarojini Naidu ji. Sarojini Naidu ji biography will be detailed by me, friends, and also her role in the Indian freedom struggle will be told by me. So this is presented by me, Harshit Devedi. If you want to follow me, the link of my Instagram profile is given in the description box below. Also, friends, this video is in English, so if you want to watch the Hindi version of this video, its link is also given in the description box. So she is also known as the Nightingale of India, we all know it. She was born on 13th of February 1879 in present day Hyderabad, friends. Her father's name was Aghornath Chattopadhyay. So obviously she belonged to a Brahmin family and her mother was Varada Sundari Devi. The name of her husband was Govinda Rajulu Naidu. Name of their children were Jay Surya, Padmaja, Randhir and Leela Mani. These are not very important, friends. She was educated from University of Madras. After that, she got a scholarship. So she lent, you know, at the age of 16, she went to King's College London and then to Girton College Cambridge. She was associated with Indian National Congress. We all know that. Many publications of her are there. For example, The Golden Threshold, published in 1905. The Bird of Time in 1912. Muhammad Ali Jinnah, an Ambassador of Unity in 1916. The Broken Wing in 1917, The Sceptred Flute in 1928, and The Feather of the Dawn was published in 1961, and she died in 1949. She passed away, unfortunately, on 2nd of March, 1949, friends. There's a memorial of her by the name of Golden Threshold, and at the Suraj, you know, and also a Sarojini Naidu Schools of Arts and Communication. This is in the University of Hyderabad. So let us have a look at it, friends. She was known for a lot of things. Slowly, one by one, I'm going to talk about all of those things, friends. She was a very good orator. She had excellent speaking skills and she was basically a poet. From that, she became an Indian independence activist and a politician. After the independence of India, she will become the governor of the then United Provinces, present-day Uttar Pradesh. So she was born on February 1879. This I already told you, 13th of February. Sarojini Naidu, her father's name was Aghornath Chattopadhyay. He was basically an educator, teacher. He was also a philosopher and a scientist. He founded the Nizam College of Hyderabad, his father. Her mother was also a poetess. She used to write Bengali poetry. She was also very talented. Her name was Varada Sundari Devi. Now, the Hyderabad section of the Indian National Congress, its first member was the father of Sarojini Naidu ji, named Aghornath Chattopadhyay. Now, Aghornath Chattopadhyay, for his initial involvements in many socio-political activities, he was being investigated for being a principal of a particular college, friends. So he was slowly involved in political activities, and obviously when you become involved in political activities, you will have to bear the consequences from the British side. Also, the brothers and sisters of Sarojini Naidu were very talented. Okay, I will tell you briefly about them. Her first brother, Virendranath Chattopadhyay, played a very important role in the establishment of Berlin community. He was heavily influenced by communism. Okay, he was also involved in India's struggle for freedom. Her second brother, Harindranath Chattopadhyay, was a good poet and a successful playwright. And her sister, Suna Lini Devi, was an actress, dancer, sort of singer. So all these brothers and sisters were very talented. Okay, so their parents were quite lucky to get all the talented children. Okay, now when Sarojini Naidu was very young, her intellect was displayed to everyone. She was a very intelligent child, and soon everybody got to know this. She was proficient not in one languages, many languages. Now, obviously, she was born in Hyderabad, friends. Her child home was Hyderabad. So being in Hyderabad, obviously, she would be knowing Telugu. She would be knowing English. But she also was proficient in Bengali, Urdu and Persian. So knowing Telugu and English to her was not a big deal. But knowing Urdu, Bengali and Persian also, and that to proficiency in all these three languages, that was a big deal. And that one play she wrote, Mahir Munir, that was in Persian. We will come to it after some time. So she used to study from Madras University and she topped her matriculation exams from the Madras University, friends. Now her father was a scientist, so he also wanted his daughter to be either a scientist or a mathematician. But Sarojini Naidu, since she was very young, had a liking for poetry. Okay, she started writing poems. She wrote a long poem in English named as a Lady of the Lake. So this Lady of the Lake was a long poem of 1300 lines. Now this poem, the use of words in it, the use of emotions in it, so this displayed the skill set, the poetic skill set of Sarojini Naidu to all the people, and father was very much encouraged by her work. Then she also wrote a play named as Maher Munir, Maher Munir. So this play Maher Munir got too much recognition, friends. Actually, she wrote it in Persian language with the help of her father. Now her father, after this play was written, distributed the copies of this play to some of his friends, relatives, people. He also sent one copy of this play to the Nizam of Hyderabad. Now when the Nizam of Hyderabad read this play, he was very, very much impressed by the the talent of this young child. So Nizam said, gave her a scholarship to go overseas and study. Very young, at the age of 16, she was sent to England to study in King's College, and after completing her studies from King's College, she went to Girton College in Cambridge. Now see, from the very young, she was talented. Now her talent was refined as soon as he reached England, because in India, the educational opportunities were very, very limited, friends. India was actually a gulam. It was a slave country at that point of time. And when she went to England, she came into touch with talented authors like Arthur Symon, Edmund Gosse. She used to talk to them. And all of these big people whom she came in touch with in England, they suggested, they also recognized the talent of Sarojini Naidu. And they suggested Sarojini Naidu to write themes which are in the context of Indian natural beauty, cultural beauty. They said to Sarojini Naidu that you do not need to get involved with the English classics. English classics are a separate thing. You should not copy the English classics. You are from India and you should include Indian themes in your poem. You should include Indian cultural traits in your poem. So this was being suggested to Sarojini Naidu from those people, and Sarojini Naidu exactly did the same. She displayed India's natural beauty, social struggle, women empowerment, religious pluralism in her poems. So all of these things she was doing, and she developed her own style, which was very much admired among the people. Now when she was in England, she met a person, the love of her life. His name was Muthiala Govind Rajulu Naidu. He was a South Indian and he was a non-Brahman physician. He was also studying, you know, there in England. He was actually a physician. So she married him at the age of 19. Now the thing is that he was non-Brahmin, and Sarojini Naidu was the son of Aghorna Chattopadhyaya, a Brahmin. So Sarojini Naidu was a Brahmin, the boy was a non-Brahmin, but despite of that, their families agreed. They were married under the Brahmo Marriage Act 1872 in Madras. This act is Brahmo Marriage Act 1872. They were married in Madras in 1898, and this was very much unusual, friends, because at that point of time, inter-caste marriage were a big deal. Inter-caste marriage were not tolerated in the society, but still they got married, and this marriage was a really happy marriage, friends, because they had 4 children and they lived happily after that. Okay, now after this, friends, slowly Sarojini Naidu ji came in touch with some people, and Indian national freedom struggle was gaining momentum, so she was naturally attracted towards it. First of all, she came in touch with people like Gopal Krishna Gokhale. Now, I've already made the biography of Gopal Krishna Gokhale, friends. It is already uploaded to my channel. You can go and watch it. Okay. So, friends, she came in touch with Gopal Krishna Gokhale. Then when Gandhiji came, she also came in touch with Gandhiji. So, then happened the partition of Bengal in 1905. So, all of these things were affecting Sarojini Naidu, because she was very much open to the problems of the Indian society. So, she decided that I will join this Indian freedom struggle. And she was inspired to do so. Gopal Krishna Gokhale inspired Sarojini Naidu ji, saying that you are so much intellectual, you are so much efficient, so much talented. Why are you not using your talent for the Indian freedom struggle? You are an Indian and you have a responsibility towards your country and society. So she decided that she will join the Indian freedom struggle. So for some time, she took a break from her writing and devoted herself to the political cause, towards the national movement. And when she plunged herself into national movement, she was with many leaders like Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, Mahatma Gandhi, C.P. Ramaswamy Iyer. C.P. Ramaswamy Iyer is a very, very important name, friends. I will make a separate video on him after some time. And Muhammad Ali Jinnah. Now, her respect for Gandhiji was huge. There was a sort of daughter-father relationship between her and Gandhiji. And she used to say Gandhiji as Mickey Mouse. Okay. So, this was a sort of bonding in between them, friends. Also, she met Jawaharlal Nehru in 1916, okay, and both Jawaharlal Nehru and Sarojini Naidu worked together in order to help the farmers of the Champaran. Because I have already told you in the video of Motilal Nehru that Jawaharlal Nehru came back to India in 1912 after studying from England in Harrow and other universities. This I have told you in the video of Motilal Nehru ji, because Jawaharlal Nehru was the son of Motilal Nehru. I will make a totally separate video on Jawaharlal Nehru also after some time. Okay, so they went to Champaran in Bihar. They fought the Britishers, they fought for the rights of the indigo peasants. Also, friends, there was one important element of the leaders of Indian National Congress at that point of time, that they used to go from place to place. The length and breadth of the country, they used to travel. The sessions of the Indian National Congress used to happen at different places. They used to go there. They used to talk to the people. They used to inspire the people with the thoughts of nationalism to fight for their cause, for their unity, for their freedom. And the point is that Sarojini Naidu ji was the flag bearer of women empowerment. At that point of time, Indian National Congress was no doubt dominated by men. Women were not so much active. Now, Sarojini Naidu ji was an exception. And she was being, inspired, and she was being instructed to lead the women of the society. She used to go from place to place, talk to the women. And she inspired the women to not only confine themselves in their home, they should come out. They should do picketing, they should fight for their country, they should do everything for the society. So she played a very big role for empowering the women of the country, friends. Also, no doubt to say, she inspired the youths, she inculcated nationalism in them. All of these things was done by her. In 1917, Sarojini Naidu ji, along with Annie Besant ji and other leaders, she founded the Women's India Association, 1917. Also, friends, She was being credited, and she has the credit of associating more and more women with the Indian freedom struggle and Indian National Congress. Also, her activities were not only limited to India. She traveled extensively throughout the world. She went to United States of America. She went to many other European countries, being the flag bearer of the Indian independence struggle, because these leaders used to go there. These leaders used to talk to the people of that country, telling them about the plight of India. These used to talk to leaders of those country, telling them to help India to gain their freedom from Britain. So all of these things they used to do. Then also in 1919, Rowlatt Act came, friends. So there was a big agitation against this Rowlatt Act. Sarojini Naidu ji participated wholeheartedly in it. Then Mahatma Gandhi ji gave the call of non-cooperation movement. Sarojini Naidu ji was the first to join this movement. She religiously followed Gandhi ji. Montagu Chelmsford reforms opposition, she was involved in it. The Khilafat issue, she was involved in it. The Satyagraha pledge, involved in it. The civil disobedience movement of 1930, the Salt Satyagraha Dharasana, that I will come after some time, she was also involved in it. What happened that I have already told you, the Salt Satyagraha thing. Poon Swaraj resolution was taken in 1930, and Gandhi ji was given the leverage to launch the civil disobedience movement in a manner of his choice. So he chose the Salt Act, the Salt Satyagraha, to initiate the civil disobedience movement, and he broke the salt law. This I have made a separate video, kindly go and watch it. Now after that, he planned to break the salt law at the Dharasana salt works. Now, as the movement was gaining momentum at that point of time, the Britishers arrested Mahatma Gandhi. So, after Mahatma Gandhi ji was arrested, Sarojini Naidu ji led the salt satyagraha to Dharasana salt works, and she completed it. After that, when in 1931, after the Gandhi-Irwin Pact, when Gandhi ji will go to participate in the second round table conference in London, then Sarojini Naidu ji will go with Gandhi ji to London. And obviously, when you are involved in all these political activities, obviously you will be not liked by the British government. So she was jailed numerous times in 1930-32, also during the Quit India movement. When she was arrested during Quit India movement, friend, she was imprisoned for a time period of 21 months. The arrest that took place from 7th of August, 7th, 8th, 9th August, and after that, within a week of Quit India movement started, within a week of 8th of August, many leaders of Indian National Congress were arrested, and they've been put in jail for a longer period of time. So that was one of the biggest periods of time of arrest of almost all the leaders. Okay, so she used to go to foreign countries as a representative of Indian National Congress. She did that in 1919 as a part of the All India Home Rule Deputation. Then what happened, friends, that two delegates were sent by Indian National Congress in January 1924 to attend the East African Indian Congress. So Sarojini Naidu was one of those members. Okay. And she has the distinction of being the second woman to be elected as the president of Indian National Congress in 1925. She is the second woman to be elected as the president of Indian National Congress in 1925. And kindly note, she is the first Indian woman to be elected as the president of Indian National Congress. Because the first woman to be elected as the Indian National Congress president is Annie Besant. And Annie Besant ji was not Indian. She was from England. So the first woman president of Indian National Congress, Annie Besant. The second woman president of Indian National Congress is Sarojini Naidu. But the first Indian woman president of Indian National Congress is Sarojini Naidu. So I hope you understood the difference. So she was the president in 1925, friends. Okay, so this I have told you. Now, after India became independent, she was one of those leaders who had the privilege, who saw, you know, she was lucky enough to survive. She was alive at the time of independence, friends. So when India became independent, she became the first governor of the United Provinces, which is the present day Uttar Pradesh. And she remained the governor till her death in 1949 on 2nd of March. And that is why that day is celebrated as Women's Day in India, friends. Now, there are many other achievements of Sarojini Naidu ji also. For example, she is very much known in the field of poetry, friends. Many of her poems have been transformed into songs. In 1905, as I have already told you, there was a collection of poems which became very famous. The title of it was Golden Threshold. Then again, more collections of Sarojini Naidu ji came out. For example, The Bird of Time, The Broken Wings. And the reader of Sarojini Naidu ji were not only limited to India. She found readers in England also. She also wrote a lot of essays. And most of these poems and essays used to highlight the social problems of India. They used to inspire people for freedom struggle, instill in them a feeling of nationalism. And the biggest thing, she focused on women empowerment, friends, that were very, very important at that point of time. So I have told you also, she has the distinction of being the first woman governor of Uttar Pradesh. Okay. On 2nd of March 1949, she died in Lucknow in Uttar Pradesh as she was the governor. So she used to be, she was at that point of time in Lucknow. And there are very glorious words of Sarojini Naidu. I will read them for you, friends. She said that, "As long as I have life, as long as blood flows through this arm of mine, I shall not leave the cause of freedom. I am only a woman, only a poet. But as a woman, I give to you the weapons of faith and courage and the shield of fortitude. And as a poet, I fling out the banner of song and sound, the bugle call to battle. How shall I kindle the flame which shall waken you men from slavery?" So by this she is saying that as long as I have life inside me, as long as this blood is flowing through my veins, I will not stop and I will fight for making my country free. She said that I am a woman and I am also a poet. So as a woman, I have the weapons of courage, I have faith, I have fortitude. And as a poet, I have the power of sound, the power of song. And by using that power of sound, I will call for battle. I will try to wake you all men to just wake up from this, you know, long sleep of slavery and fight for your freedom. So these were so much inspiring words of Sarojini Naidu ji. You can see the flame in those words, and that was very much effective in, you know, inspiring the people of India at that point of time. Now, where she passed her residence, her childhood residence at Lampalli. This was being given to University of Hyderabad by her family, and it has been named as the Golden Threshold. So this place where she used to live in her childhood, and and this Golden Threshold was also the name of her publication of poems. Did you know that 1905 collection of poems, friends? Also, in Hyderabad University, the School of Fine Arts and Communication has now been renamed as the Sarojini Naidu School of Arts and Communication. And this is there to honor Sarojini Naidu, who is also known as the Nightingale of India. Okay, friends. So you can say that she was one of the most important women flag bearers of the Indian National Congress. And she did a lot to inspire the women of this country, so that the women can also come forward and participate in the Indian freedom struggle. And much participation of the women in non-cooperation movement, in salt satyagraha, in the picketing of shops, liquor shops. So many women were inspired by Sarojini Naidu ji to do so. So I hope this video was liked by you, friends. If it was really liked by you, kindly like this video, friends. Kindly subscribe to my channel. Kindly tell me your views through your comments. If you don't like it, then also tell me your problems, friends. And as far as possible, please share this video to more and more people. So thank you, friends. Goodbye. Have a great day. Take care.